Music. It's the love of music that brings us together. The love of music that forms the bond between us. For the next hour, join us for the love of music, presenting those aspects of music which excite, provoke, and inspire. Our host today is David Dubal, WNCN Music Director, pianist, educator, and writer on music. Here is David Dubal for the love of music.
This is David Dubal, and I am so pleased today to have as my guest Raul Sunico. Well, I don't know Raul, but I do know who he is with, a very close friend of mine, Francis Heilbut. But Francis, how are you?
I'm delighted to be here. Thank you. I'm very, very well, and I'm glad to have brought Raul Sunico with me, and very happy that you would have us both.
Oh, I am so delighted. First of all, I respect your opinion on musicians, and one day recently we were talking, as we often do, on pianists and many other subjects, and you said, do you know that the American Landmarks Festival, of which you are the director, is sponsoring a pianist that you're just wild about? And I said, well, who is he? Raul Sunico. You have to hear him June 4th, and that is today. And I said, indeed, I will. And we're having him play because he's a divine pianist. We're going to hear on this program, by the way, Chopin, Ravel, Chopin again, and the Rachmaninoff First Concerto. Raul, tell me about your program, which will take place tonight.
Yes, I'm starting off with the Polonaise Fantasy of Chopin, Opus 61, followed by three mazurkas, Opus 56, and then the Brahms Variations on Handel. And after the intermission, I will proceed with the Ravel Gaspard de la Nuit and end off with the Rachmaninoff Second Sonata in B-flat minor.
All right, Raul, I will ask you a difficult question to answer. Are you either the greatest pianist in the world or insane? Which is it? That program is the program for about four mastodons. You know, Rachmaninoff said, I wrote the third concerto for an elephant.
Yeah.
Well, you're going to do the second sonata, which is the equivalent.
Yeah, well, I'd like to talk a little about this second sonata of Rachmaninoff. I feel closely attached to his third piano concerto, which has been also associated with the second sonata in B-flat minor as far as, I guess, the style and the level of difficulty is concerned.
Yeah.
And I really look forward to performing this sonata just as I was excited about performing the concerto number 3 before.
Wow. Now, you were born in the Philippines, right?
Yes.
And your early training in Manila, and then you came to New York and you studied with the famous Juilliard with Gorodnitsky.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, there are so many young pianists, and Francis Heilbut runs his Landmark Festival, and often you have you've sponsored like hundreds of pianists in performance. The important thing here is, how did you come to Raul? I know that you are taking him under your personal direction.
That's correct, David. I want to say that I have, in the last 10 years, among the thousands of concerts which we have presented, actually had over 300 solo pianists in our various series in four different states. And I came to meet Raul, who I think is special among those 300 some odd, in a very ironic way.
Tell me.
It harkens back to a tradition which you might relate to some of the great artists of the past. You have to think of Fritz Busch, for instance, who was thrown out of the Berlin Conservatory because he played piano in a cafe, in a restaurant in Berlin. That was not done in those days, and yet it is a tradition among some of the greatest artists of the past and even today that they will play in restaurants, playing good music, of course, known as café-concert.
Georgi Tsifra was quite known for that.
Oh, yes. Know. Arthur Balsam always talks about how he played trios, piano trios and so forth, in Berlin. That was a tradition. And how did I meet Raul? Well, in the same way. I happened to go to a very good restaurant where the food was recommended, and which I knew very well, very elegant, fully intending to enjoy my supper. It happened to be an anniversary occasion. I was actually going to go somewhere else, but I was taken there instead, so another irony. And as I began to enjoy my dinner, I suddenly noticed that there was piano music emanating from a distant part of the restaurant, and I listened and listened. Now, I mean, I've heard piano music in the background on many occasions, but never was I so drawn through all of the din of the dishes and the various conversations going around at the tables nearby. I have never been so drawn to piano, and it wasn't the best piano instrument as far as the technical point of view is concerned, but the playing was so great. And the person I was with said, why don't you eat? You know, your supper's getting cold. I said, my God, you're right. And but this pianist is incredible. And eventually I went up to him and I told him in one of his breaks, he was sitting down at that time, not at the piano, I said, you know, you've ruined my supper because you played so beautifully.
Mm-hmm.
And he was very, very polite and acknowledged, yes, my string beans, my gourmet avocado, everything was going to waste, you see. It was all cold by the time I was talking to Raul.
You don't just heat that up. I mean,
no,
it
just
ruins the vegetable.
That's right, yeah.
And you're a vegetarian, I know.
Exactly, right. I loved those string beans. Oh, they had a wonderful sauce. It was all cold, ice cold. But what was very warm in me was a passion for this playing.
Yeah.
And as a result, I extended an invitation to Raul to play in our series if ever he were so inclined.
Mm-hmm.
And we got to know each other that way. He has performed a number of times in our landmarks. And now we are undertaking to launch an international series.
Mm-hmm.
Since we have been dealing with foreign governments, approximately 10 different countries are interested in exchanging artists with our National Park Service series, which, as you know, is a federal agency. We would like to create new possibilities by agreement with foreign governments.
Yes.
And exchanging in landmarks of this type, but also presenting these artists in major halls and launching careers as well when they are worthwhile.
So Raul Sunico will be the pianist that will be the first foreign artist in your American Landmark
yes.
Festival series, correct?
Well, that is in the international series, and we are launching him hopefully for a major career, which I fully believe he deserves, at Alice Tully Hall today on June 4th.
And I hope that our listeners come because this program, Raul, are you getting nervous?
Well, I'm starting to feel nervous.
Oh.
It's just a few hours before I try on the whole
That's
thing.
Right. Well, you've been playing a lot. You've been playing at the 1982 World's Fair in Knoxville. And
yes.
I just don't know how anyone gets in shape, though, for quite a program like this. Gaspar de la Nuit, the Brahms Handel variation, the Rachmaninoff second sonata.
David, if I may, this is usual for Raul.
Really?
In one evening, Raul performed the Prokofiev Fourth. Or was it the Ravel, the left-hand concerto of Ravel, not the Prokofiev, the Ravel concerto, the Liszt A major, as well as the Rachmaninoff Third in one evening.
Raul, are you a fast learner? Is this possible in your life, or is it just...
I guess memory-wise, I grasp things a little easy.
How did you come to the piano in Manila?
Well, I started learning piano at the age of 5.
Mm-hmm.
But this was on a normal kind of development. I wouldn't say that I really loved the piano at the start. It was just like an activity, an extracurricular activity that I did with my friends, with my older cousins, with whom we stayed at home.
Mm-hmm.
And as we performed in student recitals, I got to enjoy playing in public.
There was no pressure on you from your family to play all the time?
No, there was no pressure
was
at
just
all.
Well, I know that you've also given performances of Filipino composers, am I right?
Yes.
You've recorded a concerto by a man by the name of Sacramento?
Yes.
Is that a very modern, difficult work?
Well, the composer Sacramento is actually a more or less a modern kind of composer. But for this particular work where he was commissioned, he went back into the romantic kind of mood.
Yes.
So these concertos that I have recorded of him are very lyrical in nature, which is not his usual style.
On your recital tonight, you're playing Chopin's Mazurka's Opus 56 and the Polonaise Fantasy, and you're opening with that, right?
Yes.
We're going to open from your recording in a Chopin number, and it's the Aeolian Harp Etude, the etude that when Schumann actually heard Chopin play, he said, it's like an Aeolian harp with all of its, with all the possible scales. So we're now going to hear you play the Opus 25, number one of Chopin. The artist, my guest today, Raul Sunico. I've just heard the Chopin Etude in A-flat, Opus 25, number 1, in the hands of my guest, Raul Sunico, my other guest today, Francis Heilbut, and we will be back right after these messages. Raul Sunico, pianist, will appear tonight. I know you're cringing, but tonight at Alice Tully Hall. I like that hall. Have you played there before?
No, this is my first time.
Uh-huh. Now, Francis, what interests me, you see, is the fact that you adore his playing and you have heard so many pianists, so many people you have put on in the American Landmarks Festival series. You are a pianist. So one is when you say I was enthralled with it, I couldn't eat the dinner. My ear pricked up at that and I said, I have to hear Raul.
I think you have to experience Raul live. In whether it be in a restaurant or in a hall or any kind of live setting. He's a very adaptable pianist. He somehow knows how to gauge the atmosphere in which he's playing to fit the sound into it, be it through the length of sustaining of sound and the rubato and so forth, the phrasing. But what impresses me about him mostly, I think, is his natural kind of playing. He has a sound which envelops. It doesn't seem to come from one particular source, but it envelops. Now, I don't know how he does that.
I want to ask him instantly. He's right here.
For instance, he played a funeral march sonata once, Chopin sonata, and the lyric part of the funeral march movement was so unearthly. Yeah. There was a spinning line and a sound that you couldn't tell where it was coming from. It was something quite extraordinary, and that is what it is, whether it be in the most forte bravura passages, In the Scarborough or in Lugibe or Ondine or Mephisto Waltz, whatever he's playing, mm-hmm. or the simplest nocturne or a mazurka, he has that way of creating a natural musical quality.
It's so great to hear another pianist talk about another one in such an impassioned
inspiring.
Way. Yeah,
inspiring.
Yeah, he has inspired you. Raul, and you're not at all embarrassed by this praise. You're just, you know, you're sick of it. That's all. You want to get home and practice or at least rest for tonight's performance. Raul, he's talking about, you know, a certain sound quality that you have, and certainly you have such mechanism to play a program like this. But would you consider yourself a natural pianist, an instinctive one, or an intellectual one? Forgetting how he describes you, do you work for a certain kind of sound or philosophy?
Well, yeah, I guess I would call my playing more instinctive mm-hmm. now than intellectual. Although when my study with Mr. Goranitsky at the Juilliard School has, of course, disciplined my playing more.
He's a very good disciplinarian, isn't he?
Very, yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I remember him very well from Juilliard. Tell me about your learning process. How do you decide? Because you have a big repertoire. Do you fall in love with certain pieces of music?
Yes, I am more exposed and I enjoy studying the Romantic literature as well as the early contemporary ones mm-hmm. and, of course, the late Romantics like Rachmaninoff.
Mm-hmm. Now, I want to ask you this. One day you're playing and Francis hears you, and Francis, who is a person who's always very helpful to people, comes and says, I want you to play all over the world. You say, oh, I just want to go home to Manila. And he says, no, your home has to be the globe. Now, how do you feel about your new management, so to speak? Because seldom, except perhaps in the case of Hurach and Rubinstein, is there this kind of combustible fuel going on.
Well, I certainly look forward to whatever plans Francis might have of me. And
I mean, Francis may have you go to the moon. I know him. You never know. You may do the first performance
well,
in the moon, a new landmark.
As long as there's a good piano on the moon, why not?
Good, why not? Okay, we're going to...
Claire de Lune.
Yeah, Claire de Lune. Yeah.
Claire de Terre.
Lunar. Now... we're going to hear the first movement of a piece that is also on your recording. Is that recording available easily?
It's not on the market yet.
Aha.
It's produced by the Phil-American Cultural Society of New York, uh-huh. which is based in Rockland. Uh-huh. And right now, although they intend to market the record, most of the records are still in their hands.
I see. Well, we're going to hear it. Even though it's in their hands, we're going to have it on the air, and we're going to hear the first movement of your performance of Ravel's exquisite Sonatine.
Thank you.
Raul Sunico has just performed for us from his yet-to-be-released recording, the first movement of Ravel's Sonatine. My guest today is Raul, as well as Francis Heilbut, a good friend of mine, and we will be back right after these messages. Francis Heilbut, the general director of American Landmark Festivals, who has taken under wing, so to speak, Raul Sunico, Filipino pianist, who is playing tonight at Alice Tully Hall. A fantastic program, Raul. I'll tell the audience what it is. I know there are not that many seats left. Very, very fantastic, by the way, for a debut, Francis.
None papered, by the way. I want to say that people really are supporting him because they know of his playing over the years. He has been here 7 years, you see. Mm-hmm. He has a master's at Juilliard and, believe it or not, even a master's in mathematics, statistics. He's a mathematician.
I noticed that on his circular, and I wondered if that statistics meant mathematics.
Well, it is a branch of applied mathematics.
So you're a brilliant creature, right? One of these. You just sit down and learn the rock third and then go on to the Ravel left hand and then perhaps, you know, do a mathematical puzzle. How I envy that kind of facility.
No, but he has performed quite a bit, and what he needs now is the real launching pad, and I think Alice Tully Hall is a landmark of sorts in that direction also, because many a fine debut artist has certainly gone on to bigger and better things from there, and we feel that Raul deserves an international career and should be playing with major orchestras everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Well, then he will.
Because he was born on February 29th, which is...
Tell me, Rossini's birthday
and leap year day, as you know. He's perhaps a little bit late in blossoming because he only has a birthday every 4 years, you see.
Well, but I won't even try to add that up because it's...
I think he will catch up and make up for the lost time. And in the meantime, he's cultivating his art, and he has an enormous repertoire and should be playing everywhere.
Well, you have played, of course. You just got back from Knoxville, the World's Fair. You've played. I see that the Vancouver Courier says you're a pianist of incredible talent. You've played in Austria. You've played in Manila, of course.
Mm-hmm. So Poland and in Spain, France, throughout the United States.
So you have really geared yourself to the big career, right? This will be what you expect of yourself, so to speak. You would like that.
Well, I would like this performing thing, of course, to continue and perhaps even on a bigger scale.
Yeah. Oh, I think Raul is ready. I think that was one of the only, shall we say, challenges that I presented to him after I heard him a number of times in performance. I wanted to make sure that he really wanted a career.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's one thing to have the talent and the ability. It's another to want it.
Mm-hmm.
And to be able to handle it from all points of view, mentally, psychologically,
spiritually. Well, from hearing
and even physically. I mean,
physically.
It is a grueling work. I think our public still doesn't realize that it's not just tinkling at home for one's amusement. It is grueling work,
Francis,
for
the
benefit of mankind.
The public doesn't really understand that if they actually looked at the history of the performing art, pianist, violinist, that three-quarters, if not more, packed the career in because of the grueling aspects of it.
Yeah. Yes, and you see nowadays, since the piano is no longer a home, shall we say, an integral home item, as you say, people don't know how difficult it is. They don't really play the way they used to in the Victorian times when every home had to have a piano. Now they push a button and they hear a great pianist on the radio or on television, and they think, oh, look how easy it is. I just have to push the button.
They don't
realize the effort. And I think in the last century, they did much more realize how great a labor and art an instrumentalist really did acquire.
Absolutely. Once a house was not a home without its piano.
Exactly.
Now the instrument is the gramophone.
Of course, they played everything. The symphonies and their operas and
everything.
Chamber music.
There was no way
house
of getting...
House music was what was so popular. And I wish that would come back in a way because it activates people, of course.
Oh, sure.
And doesn't make them so passive. We'd like them to come out to the concerts a little bit more, too. Yeah. I love the radio, and we can't
Tell
live without it anymore.
Tell me about your general director and founder of this...
The American Landmark Festivals, yeah. Well, this has been going on now for 10 years, and we are affiliated by contract with the National Park Service under the United States Department of the Interior, and are allowed to use federal properties, landmarks such as Castle Clinton, Independence Hall, Theodore
for
Roosevelt
concerts,
Birthplace.
Huh?
We adapt them to all of the performing arts and even visual arts. Mm-hmm. We do have exhibitions now, and we've also had lectures, but I would say mainly musical events. And we've had literally thousands since we began in 1972, and we have branched out to four different states and would like the National Park Service to cooperate with us all through the country, and through this federal affiliation, mm-hmm. we would like to develop the ties, which I formerly mentioned, about foreign governments, the ties with landmarks abroad, and artists who would reciprocate their talents and appear by government agreement.
Sounds fantastic, Francis.
Well, the artists need opportunities, as you know.
Gosh, yes.
Not everyone can do a Tully Hall every year, for instance. It's an enormous expense to put that on, and artists don't have it.
That's right.
And so they have to be given opportunities wherever it's feasible.
That's right. Raul, we were talking about the piano in the household, and that, you know, in America and in the West, it's certainly the electronic age has made it die off. What about in the Philippines? Is there still domestic piano playing at home?
Yeah. Even until now, I think that the piano is actually a kind of basic furniture in the house, mm-hmm. and at least every child or maybe even every girl has to study the piano at one point or another.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just unfortunate that the opportunities in the Philippines are still developing.
Yes.
And there are a lot of talented young people in the Philippines who would like to pursue music or other forms of arts, but because of financial difficulty or, you know, the lack of competent instruction, mm-hmm. They're just not given the proper opportunity.
Yeah.
And through this foundation, which has sponsored my studies here, which is called the Young Artists Foundation of the Philippines, mm-hmm. At least we are starting to develop whatever talent or people that are in need of further advancement in music and the arts.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope that in the future there will be a bigger number of Filipino artists that should be given the opportunity to pursue their studies.
And I hope that's true, and that I hope it will happen. Tell me, who in your growing up, who are the pianists, for instance, that have made an impact on you? Arthur Rubinstein, for example, did he have any impact?
Well, I happen to be exposed to just a few of the mm-hmm. of the great pianists, because
growing up, they didn't come often to Manila, correct?
Well, yeah, and besides, the recordings that we have available of them are not as many as you would find them here, of course.
Uh-huh.
I was exposed to pianists like Van Cliburn mm-hmm. and Vladimir Horowitz, Arthur Rubinstein, and some of the visiting pianists like Gary Graffman and mm-hmm. Andre Watts and Vladimir Ashkenazi.
Yeah. When did you first, can you remember, hear the most famous of the Chopin Polonaises, which we will be hearing right now in your own hands, the A-flat? Do you have any recollection of when those bars first hit your ears?
Well, if I remember right, I think I heard that piece in its popular version. As you know, that there is a popular version of this Polonaise, which is still the end of time.
Yeah.
Which, coincidentally, is also the theme song of my parents.
Really?
And
how do you mean the theme song of your parents?
Well,
do they have a program or?
Not.
It's just
by theme song, I mean, like, maybe the song that reminds them of one another.
Ah, their favorite, yeah, yeah.
And the first time I heard this on its classical version, I think was a recording by Van Cliburn,
yes,
which I still have at home.
In his album called My Favorite Chopin.
Yes.
You see these titles work, My Favorite Chopin and Till the End of Time. And we will now hear the Chopin Polonaise in A-flat, Opus 53, sometimes known as the Heroic, and it demands an heroic octave technique. We're going to hear Raul Sunico, from his yet-to-released recording, play the Chopin work.
Thank you.
called the Eroica Polonaise, the Heroic Polonaise of Chopin, and we heard it heroically stated by my guest today, the artist Raul Sunico, who is playing tonight. He doesn't seem at all nervous, Francis, and he's going to be doing a very trying recital, including, well, you're not doing the A-flat Polonaise, but you are opening with even greater work, in my opinion, the Polonaise Fantasy, Opus 61, then the three late mazurkas, Opus 56, which are extraordinary creations, still unknown, really, in many ways, followed by the Brahms Handel, the Variations in Fugue on a theme of Handel, one of the most muscular of Brahms' works. Then one of the legendary pieces in the piano literature, practically a badge for contemporary virtuosity, is Gaspard de la Nuit. And then a work in some ways, and how you'll follow Gaspard with the second sonata in B-flat minor of Rachmaninoff, we're not sure. It's the original version, which is even longer than the one Horowitz does. Well, I'm exhausted talking about it. You'll be leaving the studio at WNCN shortly to go home, probably to rest. Is there a certain procedure that you follow before a recital, Raul?
I used to take a short nap before, if I could.
Do you have a lot of stage nerves, or is that not part of your psyche?
Well, I guess it's natural for everyone to be nervous about it, but if you are prepared for what you will be doing, it's more of an anxiety, more than nervousness.
You are prepared?
Anticipation, I think, is the word.
Anticipation, yeah. Yes.
You feel prepared? I remember that I once read that Paderewski said that real bad stage nerves are just merely bad conscience. Do you have that?
Well, right now I feel prepared. But, you know, a few minutes before I walk out there, sometimes you feel like you don't even know what the first note is. And I have felt that way several times in the past.
Well, I tell you that I'm going to be there tonight, but I'm glad I'm not attempting such a program. What about you, Francis?
I'm glad he is, because with all his modesty, he really can do it, and he could do it twice over. And I think given the audience response, there will be quite a few stunning encores as well. Stamina doesn't seem to be Raoul's problem. Neither physical nor mental. He has it all there. It's present. And having played this program now in certain run-throughs for private audiences, I think he has the confidence to play it, and he could sit down and play another program the following day, different repertoire.
So, Raul, strength is not your problem ever?
Well, I guess I haven't really encountered it as a problem before.
I would say that it's not. As I see you, I would estimate that you were 7'3", around 400 pounds, right? This is to tantalize. Well, actually, there are so few tickets left,
That's
right?
Correct. That is correct. But he does know how to economize his efforts.
You know, we're going to hear, Raul, a live performance, I believe. Am I right?
Yes, this is a live performance in Manila.
This is in Manila. The conductor is, his name is Regalado Jose.
Yes.
And you're performing the first movement here, all of it, but we only have time for the first movement of the Rachmaninoff First Concerto, which is not as known as the second or third, and quite wonderful. That cadenza is brilliant, isn't it?
Oh, yeah. I love that piece.
You love this piece. You love Rachmaninoff, don't you?
Yeah, he's one of the
How did you come to Rachmaninoff? What happened in your early life? That did you hear records of Rachmaninoff himself?
No, I have records of Rachmaninoff, but I just acquired these recently. The first pieces that exposed me to Rachmaninoff were his preludes, and of course the Concerto Number 2, which I like very much also. And which, like the Heroic Polonaise, has also been subjected into its popular version.
The second concerto tonight we love. We all know the titles, too. It's amazing. Anyway, we're going to hear you with the Cultural Center of the Philippines Philharmonic, Jose conducting, and my guest today, who will be playing tonight, Rachmaninoff's second sonata. We'll hear him now in the Concerto Number 1 of Rachmaninoff, the first movement, Raul Sunico. Thank you. Well, Raul, as they say in America, wow. The sparks were flying, and very elegant playing, too, in the Rachmaninoff. First, you were on the stage of the Cultural Center of the Philippines, Philharmonic, Regalado, Jose conducting, and I'll be back with a final word with both you and Francis right after this message or two. And the audience, of course, will excuse the fact that it's not the usual recording standard, but that the live performance way across the world in the Philippines, right? You
yes.
are, as they say, in the sense of, well, I would say a rising star. You're a brilliant pianist, and I am just so glad.
Thank you very much.
That you have come to talk to me. And Francis, it's always a pleasure to see you and talk to you.
Thank you for having us, David.
Best of luck tonight.
Thank
Raul
you, David.
Sunico will be playing at Tully Hall. Good luck. This is David Dubal. Thank you for listening.
For the Love of Music, with today's host, David Dubal, WNCN Music Director. We hope you'll be with us when once again we meet to listen and exchange ideas, all for the love of music. For the Love of Music is produced by WNCN New York, GAF Broadcasting Company.